It's the Stormy Warren Show on the highway. Blake Shelton is with us. We've been talking about body language for months now, and it is finally out. We finally have it available for everybody. 12 tracks, 12th studio album. Any correlation there? You like the number 12?
Oh, wow. I didn't even realize that. You're always breaking the headlines here on this show. Oh, it's always breaking news with you. I'm impressed.
Yeah. 12 studio album, body language. And yes, that is the smart ass Blake Shelton. He's back with us again. And I love it. Wouldn't have him any other way. We've already got two big old hits, Minimum Wage and Happy Anywhere. And now we get to experience the other 10. And it's diverse. It's all over the place. And it's everything we want from Blake Shelton with a little bit of grounding force along the way. You're very specific about wanting to have all of those things represented on an album, right?
I guess I was trying to describe, it dawned on me the other day, I was doing an interview and a question came up like, you know, what do you want people to take away from this album? And it dawned on me, it's like, man, I don't think I have much to say anymore, really. I just like great country songs, and I don't think there's a one message on the album. I realized I haven't done that in a while, or for most of my career, even where I set out to go, you know, maybe about two times I've done it where I thought, you know, I want people to get this message from the album, because most of the time I'll just record songs that I love, and I don't even care if one contradicts the next one on the album. You can put them back to back on the album for all I care. You know, I want the best songs that I can get my hands on, because I love country music, and that's what I want to say is just, hey, man, you got to hear Bible verses, man. They wrote the hell out of this song. You know, you got to hear it. And that's what gets me fired up, is just crazy, crazy lyrics and excellent writing, you know.
Bible verses, you brought it up. That one punches you in the gut, because I've never heard it written that way. I don't know why this hasn't been written this way, and I'm sure
I know, right? You. I know.
It's just unbelievable. Never even thought to use verses in that way when it's talking to the Bible. Bible verses, or the Bible versus me. Yeah. Where did that take you? I mean, it's like, why did it affect you that way?
Well, it's just any time a song, you know, I can remember a few times where people say, you know, man, I had to pull over on the side of the road, and I didn't do that, but I always remember the first time I hear songs that, you know, shock me like that. Remember, Aaron Tippin had a song years ago that was, the hook was, she said, I'm leaving. And then it goes to the chorus, and the hook was, I'm leaving you for me.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember going, whoa, what the hell? I didn't see that coming, you know? And Bible verses had that same effect on me. It's like, I could tell where the song was going. Like, you know, this guy, he just doesn't feel like he measures up to the man that he knows he needs to be. And to the point where sometimes he almost feels like he's butting heads with the Bible and that watermark, you know what I mean? And he just can't win, you know? And I think, I can't speak for everybody, but I feel like that pretty often.
Sure. I mean, if you say you haven't felt like this, you're lying to yourself and everybody around you. I mean, that's what makes it so universal and beautiful. I mean, we all have songs that the perfect twist on the phrase is just what just goes, oh, that's beautiful.
That's what I love about country music, is when it happens.
We were talking about turns on phrases, and you're attracted to that. I think any music fan is attracted to that. Making it up as you go. I mean, talk about, there's another one that just has the perfect twist on the phrase, making it up as you go. And that's, there's another one. And so many other songs of this have that thing. Do you just, kick yourself for not being that good of a writer? Cause I mean, that's what I do when I hear songs like that.
I just quit writing. I just, that's it. Screw it. I'm not even going to try anymore. It's like, these guys are really good at what they do. Let them do their thing. I'll be more than happy to stick my voice on these things. I love that song. You know, I love the hook of it. And the other thing I love about it is just I don't know, it's kind of got that beach yacht rock thing about it, you know, and I've tried over the years to crack that code. And I think Sun Beach is probably as close as I've gotten, which doesn't, by the way, I'm not saying it qualifies. I don't think it qualifies. It's more of just kind of a,
it's clunk. As close as you've gotten.
It's more of the lake than it is the beach. Let's face it.
You also have a love song on Body Language, Blake Shelton, an unlikely love song about a vegetable.
Hey, listen, all jokes aside, I was so technically Happy Anywhere is the first single off of this album, I guess, because it was out there without a home for so long. We finally decided to let it move in with this album. And so then it came time to decide what the next thing was going to be off this record. And I made a serious run at the label and my management to get Korn out as the next single, because I love Korn, right? I mean, like, who doesn't love Korn? Korn is in your life every day, whether you realize it or not. We're drinking it. We're eating it. We're driving past it. It's everywhere. And I pleaded my case on this conference call, and finally, I think it may have been Narvel, my manager, but it could have been John Esposito. Somebody finally spoke up, and they were like, "Hey, listen, Blake, we get it. We're just not sure everybody else in the world is as excited about Korn as you are." You know, I'm like, "What do you mean? How can they not be?" I'm still not finished, Stormy. I still am going to make another run at trying to get Korn out there, because every interview I do about this album, somebody asks me about Korn. It could be because it's a stupid song title, but it could be because it's an awesome song. I'm not sure. Let me ask you something. I was thinking about this. Was it when I first met you, was it TNN, or did I meet you on GAC?
You met me in the bridge between. I was just quit working for TNN because TNN folded. It just disappeared.
Yeah. Turned into Spike TV. That's right. So it wouldn't have been TNN.
No, and I didn't start with GAC till 2003. So it was somewhere in that window. And I was working over at another production company at the time. But we met over at your manager's office. And for the very first time, and I remember that.
Right, in John Doris's office, I believe. Yeah.
Well, actually, it was at Starstruck.
So we were renting my now manager's office.
Okay. Yes, exactly. I want to talk about the Swan Brothers and how you haven't given up on them. They haven't given up on you. They were on your team on The Voice. We fell in love with them. I've traveled around on USO tours with them. I love them to death. They're just two of the best dudes on the planet. Really? How satisfying was it for you to get them involved in this with a song that you legitimately fell in love with?
I probably had the same feeling about it as you do, just knowing that it happened for them. Because anybody that's ever met these guys, you can't help but love these guys and pull for them and want success for them, because they, first of all, they're so talented and they work so freaking hard at it, man. I hire the Swan Brothers every year to play Old Red and Tishomingo for Thanksgiving. That's their weekend, Thanksgiving weekend. And last time we had them in there,
A couple of good Okies.
They show up and Zach has now learned how to like play piano and a kick drum at the same time, and he's also wearing a guitar. Like, you're going, oh my God, how are you doing all this? But anyway, I've stayed in pretty close touch with him ever since, what was that, 2012 or 13, I guess. Yeah. And they've just consistently, you know, reached out. They've bounced songs, you know, off of me over the years. What do you think about this? You know, we're still working on it. Or a lot of questions, just in general career questions, you know, but what I love about how this happened is the song didn't come from those guys. It came from Scott Hendricks, just sent me four or five songs to listen to that had been pitched to me. And I said, man, I love that Body Language song. In fact, at the time it was called, the song was called Without Saying a Word. That's what the song was. And I said, man, put that on hold. I want to cut that. I think it doesn't sound like anything else, you know, that I've heard on a radio, and especially for me. And not till then did he say, by the way, that's your Swan Brothers, you know? And I was like, oh my God, it makes it even better. It didn't genuinely hit my button.
Without knowing that it was them.
That's right. That's right. I love that for them, you know? So obviously I wanted to have them feature them on the song and have their backgrounds on there. And I really just tried to make the same record as what the demo they pitched me. If we're just being honest, you know, they killed it.
This is something for our social media page, because it is a visual, but I think we can describe it as we go along. The album is called Body Language. I want your top four favorite body language gestures, which need no explanation. I should be able to understand exactly what you mean or are trying to say to me just through the use of a gesture. What are your four favorite gestures.
Okay, well, the first one that comes to mind is the one that we'd go up to, you know, meet a girl at the bar or whatever, and if she gave you the Heisman, which is this, you know, that's a good gesture right there. You know, it's not going to happen.
Not going to work. Bye bye.
And then another gesture, you know, I guess I'll just go ahead and you can.
There he is. The expected one. Yes, yeah. That was the bird, in case you were wondering, listening at home.
And the other one is this one. You know, just you got to wink.
Does that mean okay? You're right. What does that mean?
I don't really know what it means. You know, sometimes
it was a wink. By the way, Blake just did a good old wink.
Good old fashioned wink. I don't know what the hell that means. I didn't invent it, Stormy. I'm just trying to think of some damn gestures here.
And the final one.
I guess the other one would be this one.
You know. He's gagging. Yes, the finger down the throat, the gag. That is beautiful. The four gestures that are universal.
Yeah, the Heisman, that's the one to look out for, guys. If a girl gives you the Heisman, you know it's not happening.
I love it. We're down to the top five on The Voice. We are glued to it. It's very exciting. And thanks for bringing Ian Flanagan back, too. That was a lot of fun.
Oh, my gosh. I'm so happy for that guy. The performance, I guess, did well because his song shot up on iTunes. And he texted me this morning. He's just still – he can't believe it. So, and he deserved – what an amazing voice, you know.
Well, that's what you do. You never let go. You haven't let go to the Swan Brothers, Ian Flanagan, or country music, thank God. So, Blake Shelton, we love you, pal.
Thank you, buddy. Love you, too. Good to see you.